So, compared to the previous presentation of my colleagues, Benjamin Coria, Robert Gutmann, and Robert Boyer, my presentation will be to some extent different, I guess, because it will be maybe more focused on a specific topic, which is an important topic, but maybe more specific. It's a question of financial regulation, okay, which is a very, very important topic today. It's a lot of debate, a lot of controversies, so it's an interesting topic. So I hope that for those of you who are not specialized in these questions, you will like it, will at least take some advantage of my presentation, okay? So let's start as a way of introducing the topic with the different concepts which you are familiar with, I suppose. Concept of financialization, globalization, and so on. I will go very fast, but this will help me introduce my topic. Well, we can say that today our economic system has two major top features. You can add extra features, but I think for me, two major features, which is it is finance-led. Okay, the dominant role of finance, and we call sometimes very often this system the finance-led capitalism. You know, in terms of regulationist theory, Robert Boyer theory, for instance. Okay, maybe he mentioned this type of concept in his presentation. And the second characteristic of our economic system is it is global. In other words, we have now a global system. When I say global, it's on geographical grounds. In other words, it's all on the planet, all over on the planet. You have almost no country now who is not on this regime of finance-led capitalism. But as the regulationist people say, and I agree completely, you have what we call a variety of capitalism. Okay, in other words, the Chinese capitalism has nothing to do to a large extent with the US capitalism or to the German capitalism, but there are some important common features, among which the fact that they are finance-led, but also they are in a global system, okay, which is very important. Okay, and we use very often the concept of financial globalization to characterize this idea, these two ideas of globalization and financialization. According to me, this system, the existence of the system, which emerged in the, let's say, the 70s, okay, is characterized by the fact that we have dominant actors in this system, which are global banks, okay, international investors, okay, and central banks. As you have seen in the recent years, with the financial crisis, for instance, you have seen that global banks played a very important role in explaining the development of the crisis. And what are the actors who play a very important role in regulating the system, in avoiding the collapse of the financial system, are the central banks, which are very, very powerful actors. And the second characteristic of our system today, clearly, is this, what we may call it systemic instability. In other words, we are now in a regime of permanent crisis. It is my analysis. The subprime crisis is not over. Or more, I would say, we are now in a crisis which will last for years, going from one type of crisis to the other. Okay, we have different types of bubbles, for instance. We have different types of crisis. We have the sovereign debt crisis after the credit consumer crisis or the real estate crisis, and we had also a raw materials crisis, you know. And so we are in a permanent regime of instability, and one of the major causes or major mechanisms beyond this is the dominant role of finance. So this is my view. And since we have this problem of instability, we need to think in terms of regulation or new forms of regulations. The forms of regulation which prevailed in the 70s or the 80s are completely old-fashioned, are completely inefficient. So the idea is, what should we do? So as an economist and as a heterodox economist, I have ideas of what we should do. But what I will present to you is what has been done and what could happen in the future. So this will be my presentation. So my presentation will be in three parts. One is, what did we learn from the crisis? Okay, for this recurrent crisis. What have been the major reforms implemented to improve financial regulation, and what do we think about it? Are they sufficient? Are they efficient? And third, I tried to do with a bunch of colleagues, we had a contract with the European Commission to try to think of the world economy and the European economy in the coming decades, up to 2030. It's a very difficult task. So we tried to make scenarios of what could happen in different domains. It could be agriculture, it could be energy, and I worked on the question of finance. What could be the financial system? How could it evolve in the future? So I will mention that as the third part of my presentation. So first, what did we learn about from the crisis? Well, here are 5 points. We could add a list much longer, but at least 5 points. Everyone, including the orthodox people, agree that we had a deficit of financial and banking regulation, the first point. So I will go back to each of these points after. That prudential regulation, so this is more heterodox, what I'm going to say now, that the existing dominant form of regulation, which is called prudential regulation by the Basel Committee, didn't work well, had, in fact, perverse effects. Myself, I'm going as far as to say that one of the causes of the subprime crisis, and it's the fact that it's been lasting long and it's been not been solved, is due to the fact that the Basel Committee regulation is a factor of crisis in itself. So you would not see many people saying that, except among the heterodox economists. Third, the question of the central banks. The central banks, we have seen, have played a major role, as I said before, in the world economy and in the attempt to stabilize the financial system. So there has been a debate on the role of central banks. So on one side, I will come back to that, most economists today think that we should broaden the role of central banks because they are very efficient when they intervene on financial markets, for instance, or when they regulate banks. But as radical economists, heterodox economists, we have a problem. If we give a broader role to central banks, then should they remain completely independent if they have such a huge power in the world economy? So this is a problem which is interesting to talk about. Another topic which is quite new, maybe some of you didn't hear about it until now, is the question of what we call bank resolution. In other words, what happens when a bank is failing? Okay, too big to fail. Okay, what do we do with big banks? Should we rescue them? Should we let them go bankrupt? Or to what extent should we help them? Because this is very costly. This is a taxpayers who are paying, so what should we do? So this is a major problem. Should we bail out the banks? In other words, should the taxpayer pay, or should we bail in the bank? Should it be the shareholders, only the shareholder who pay for the deficit and for the rescue of the banks? So this is an interesting topic also. And finally, the fifth topic I mentioned, among many others could be mentioned, is this question. I'm sure this one you heard about it because there has been a huge debate in the US, in Europe, and so on. Is the question of separation between retail and investment banking. Okay, should we separate the two activities? Of course, I am very much in favor of this separation, but to some extent, this is very much criticized, this view, and in particular by the banking lobby, of course. Okay, so let's start now with the first point. The deficit in terms of banking regulation. If some of you are interested in the question of regulation, in particular in Europe, we have a very interesting report by Larosière at the beginning of the crisis in 2009. Jacques Larosière is a liberal. This guy was at the head of the Banque de France and also at the IMF for a few years. He's not a radical, far from being. But at the beginning of the crisis, he said, we have a problem. The crisis has been caused by a deficit of financial regulation. That's interesting, because these people would not say that before the crisis. They would say the system is working fairly well. We should not have too much regulation because this is bad for the working of the system. And the crisis changed the mind of a lot of people, saying we need more regulation. In other words, financial regulation went much too far. So for us, it has been a kind of victory on the moment. We said, look, all the ideas we were developing, you know, before the crisis, saying financial deregulation is a big problem, we're going to have more instability and so on. People were looking at us saying, oh, these people are not very serious. And now we see people, official people, saying there is a problem of regulation, there is a problem of deficit of regulation. But as you will see, they realized that there was a deficit of regulation, but they did not go very far in terms of financial regulation, re-regulation. I'll talk about that in a moment. So there is also this idea that there is no invisible hands in financial markets. In terms of theory, it is very important to realize that financial markets are not comparable to goods and services, market for goods and services, okay? They have very specific mechanisms, and they have what we may call built-in mechanisms which lead spontaneously, in an endogenous manner, to instability. This is a Keynesian theoretical view, of course. It's not the neoclassical view. It's a theoretical framework developed by Keynes. And in this university, in CEPN, a lot of us agree with this Keynesian or post-Keynesian view of money and finance, saying that it leads the system as it works is fundamentally unstable. Okay? So this view now, a lot of people agree with this view, although it was not the case a few years before. So the market efficiency hypothesis does not hold. This is a consequence of the first thing, the first idea, no invisible hand. But if you go to other university, if you go, for instance, to the most important French university, the one in finance which is maybe the most well-known is the one, at least in Paris, is Dauphine, Paris Dauphine University. If you look at the program, if you look at what is taught to the students, the major item is still the theory of market efficiency. So, in fact, most academics would agree that this hypothesis does not hold, but still the problem is that it is still the major, you know, theoretical framework taught to students. So here you are very lucky in this university, because we will not spend much time dealing with this theory, which is interesting as an abstract view of reality, but it's so far away from reality that it's not very interesting. And it's a very misleading theoretical approach. So for us, clearly, the Keynesian view, which has been enriched by many, many other economists, the most important one maybe is, I'm sure you heard of him, Hyman Minsky, really with this famous instability hypothesis, okay, brings us a very comprehensive and very realistic view of the financial system. Okay, so and it's interesting to see that last year, Mr. Trichet, who was at the head of the ECB, came to make a conference to your colleagues of last year. And this guy, for many years, when he was at the head of the ECB, was very much in favor of this idea, his invisible hand, efficiency of markets. And at the end of the last 6 months of his mandate, you know, he was mentioning a lot Minsky. So it was very funny to see that, because he realized that, in fact, this view of finance, that is the view that finance is unstable by itself, is very important. It's very important for a central banker. Why? Because if you have this view, then you have a different approach to the way you regulate the system, you know, compared to the central banker who thinks the system is fairly stable and you should only change a few things, you know, to improve the regulation. So this is interesting. Okay? So now, this question of the role of the Basel Committee. Here we have a kind of paradox. The Basel Committee, I don't know if you know what it is, it was created in 1974 when we had the first big banking crisis with a systemic risk. And this was linked to the fact that the dollar, we had the collapse of Bretton Woods system, we had unstable exchange rates, and a lot of banks got into trouble because they were not they did not know how to manage this foreign exchange risk, okay? And we had banks in Germany, in the US, and other countries who were in trouble, and this created a big systemic risk for the whole European and even international system. So the bankers, central bankers, got together and decided to create a committee in Basel, in Switzerland, at the BIS, the Bank of International Settlements, to think of what new forms of regulation should be implemented to avoid or at least to prevent some of this big systemic risk. And one of the famous measures, I'm sure you heard of it, even if you're not specialist of this question, is what we call the Cook ratio or the capital ratio, which was to impose to the bank the fact that they should hold a ratio between the risk they have in the balance sheet and their own funds. Okay, and this was a very important measure. The idea is to push the bank to have enough funds to be able to face deficits in the future if they have too much risk, you know, and they have too much loss. Okay, and this was very important. This is why I say it's paradoxical, because at the beginning I thought it was a very good innovation. The Basel Committee is what we may call a financial institutional innovation, which is unique because it's a supranational organization, okay, above the states and the governments, run by the central bankers who work together. Okay, central bankers, at the beginning it was a G10 countries, and now it's a G20. Okay, they work together. And they, the rules which are proposed by the Basel Committee are not compulsory, because we have not a supranational parliament. We cannot vote for these rules. So the Basel Committee says, look, I recommend the banks to implement this in this measure. And in fact, due to the competition on the markets and the role of institutions like rating agencies, the banks are in fact forced to implement this measure. Because if they don't do it, then they have bad rating. And then they will, when they borrow on the market, they will pay more. They have a higher risk premium and so on. So in fact, although it's not compulsory principle, in fact, all banks have to respect these prudential rules. And it is called prudential because there is this idea that it's a way to prevent in advance future problems by taking some measures supposed to push banks to be more, to take more less risks, okay? The problem is that the Basel regulation had major problems. One is that it has procyclical effects. I don't know if you are familiar with this concept of procyclicality. It's the idea is that the Basel rules, in particular the capital ratio, push banks to lend more when the upturn of the cycle, when the cycle is going up, in other words, when everything is going well, okay, then they are optimistic. They will think that they have enough funds, so they will lend to the business firms, to the household, and so on. And when the system is going down, when the cycle is going down, then they would break. They push on the brakes more due to the presence of this ratio, because then they realize that they don't have enough own funds to face the risk. Okay? So it's a factor of instability, built-in instability, to have this ratio, what we call the pro-cyclical effect. The other major limit of the few of the two, Basel I and Basel II. Basel I was in the 80s, and Basel II was in the late 90s, early 20, you know, beginning of this century, okay, 2000, just before the crisis, that they had no macroprudential supervision. So here we have a concept. I suppose most of you are aware of this concept, but just to be very clear, we have two dimensions in terms of regulation and supervision. What we call the micro supervision, in other words, the supervision of each individual banks, and the macro supervision, the supervision of the system as taken as a whole. And the macro supervision takes into account the interactions between banks and financial markets, and so on. It's more, much more difficult, in fact, to implement, but it is extremely important. The macroprudential regulation has to do what we call the systemic risk. In other words, the global risk of the system, banking system. Whereas the microprudential regulation has to do with the individual risk of individual banks. Okay? And the Basel Committee and a lot of economists, by the way, the French Nobel Prize, Jean Tirole, made this mistake himself. These people were thinking before the crisis that it's enough, it's sufficient to have micro regulation, because if all individual banks behave well, then the system will be in good shape. This is a neoclassical view, okay, that all agents are behaving in the same manner. If they behave well, everything is fine, and they don't take into account the interactions between the economic agents, okay? And Keynes and all the economists, this is what they introduce. They say, look, even if everyone is behaving well in his own field, you can have a risk, a global risk, because you may have bad interactions between the units and between the banks. And macroprudential regulation deals with that. And we were about, let's say, 10 years before the crisis, we were a bunch of economists, not only in France, but many other countries, in the US, in other European countries, saying, look, this question of macroprudential regulation is extremely important. And the people, let's say the orthodox economists like Jean Tirole, or people in IMF would say to us, look, this is not important. What is important is microprudential regulation. Now, thanks, if I may say so, to the crisis, everyone agrees that we need the two dimensions of regulation, micro and macro. I would say, if we compare the banking sector to other sectors of the economy, when we talk about the banking sector, we say banking system. When you think of the chemistry sector, of automobile industry sector, you don't say system, okay? So this is an important terminology. In other words, this is the system of the sector of the economy which is the most systemic, in the sense that the interactions between the units are extremely important to understand what's going on, and for questions of stability and instability. Okay? So if you recall this unique idea, this would be important, at least for today's presentation. So I would go faster for the other points. The Basel Committee didn't deal with the question of liquidity. In other words, what is important is banks need liquidity. And what happens if one bank is in trouble? All other banks would stop lending to this bank. And then you would have a liquidity crisis. And this is exactly what happened, for instance, when you had the Lehman Brothers collapse. The whole system almost collapsed because all banks stopped lending to each other, because they were afraid to lend to other banks who might be in trouble in the future. So this is a huge problem. I think the Basel, we'll come back on that if you have questions, system put too much emphasis on the capital requirements. For me, it has very perverse effects to do that. Why? Because what caused the financial crisis in particular is that the fact that the bank are behaving within a shareholder system. In other words, the goal of banks is to provide, you know, dividends to their shareholders and to have the highest possible level in the short run of capital, you know, return. Okay? And if you do that, you take a lot of risk. So the paradoxical effect of the Basel Committee requirements is that it is supposed to help banks to be more prudent, to avoid the future risk. But in fact, by putting too much emphasis on the capital, it pushes banks, in fact, to take risks. I don't know if I am clear. And when I say that, I must say I am in a minority position. Among even among radical economists, among my friends, even in Paris 13, this view is not shared by all of us, but all of them. But my view is that we should diversify the rules and the ratios of regulation, and put too much emphasis on capital is very bad for the reason I just mentioned. Okay. And also, the problem of the Basel Committee is that it focused only on banks and not on all financial actors. Or as you know, I'm sure you heard of it, we had the development of what we call the shadow banking system. In other words, you had quasi-banks. We are not formally banks. We were lending, taking risk, as banks are doing, but without being regulated, because they were not considered as banks. And this is part of the problem. So we should broaden, in fact, the perimeter of the regulation, include banks, but also quasi-banks, or banks which are very close to banks, in other words, to avoid future problems in the banking system, taken broadly speaking, banks and shadow banks. Now, myself, I've been doing a lot of research in recent years, since the beginning of the crisis, with respect to the role of the bank, of the central banks. Before the crisis, there was a view called the separation principle, which is nothing to do with the separation of investment banks and retail banks. There was this view developed by the monetarist school, which was that monetary stability, which is under the responsibility of the central bank, okay, should be separated from the question of banking and financial stability, which should be under the responsibility of other authorities. In other words, we should have a specialization on one side, central bank dealing with monetary stability, fight inflation, for instance, okay, and on the other side, we should have financial authorities. One country which applied this, implemented this view the most is probably the UK. I don't know if you are there people from UK here? No? Okay. In the UK, you had the Bank of England, which is the central bank, okay, and one side you had the FSA, Financial Service Authorities. And these two institutions were completely separated. On one side, the central bank would deal with monetary stability. On the other side, FSA was in charge of financial and banking stability. And they would not cooperate. They would be independent and they would not cooperate. And one of the reasons why the banking and financial crisis has been so deep in Great Britain is due to this mistake to separate completely these two dimensions of stability, which is monetary stability on one side, financial stability on the other side. Okay, so here comes into the picture some Hyman Minsky. Hyman Minsky developed a theory or a paradox, which he called the tranquility paradox. I don't know if you heard about it. Tranquility paradox. The idea is the following: when everything goes well, when there are no specific problems, it is at this time that banks, investors, are taking risks and are preparing the next crisis. In other words, when you are in a situation where everything is well, then you can be sure that a new crisis will come. This is the paradox of tranquility. Myself, I was in the just before the crisis, with a colleague, I was working on the spreads, the credit spreads. You know what it is, okay? I was astounded to see that in 2007, just before the crisis, the credit spread, or the bonds, the spread on the bond market, if you prefer, also, were almost zero. In other words, they were, the spread is a measure of risk, or a risk premium, okay? It is, as you know, the difference between the most secure bond or credit and the most, you know, risky one. For instance, Greece in Europe, when you would look at the spread between Greece and Germany with respect to the public bonds, no spread. No spread. Why? Well, because there was a lot of confidence. Everything was doing well. And it is at this time that the French banks, the German banks, the Spanish banks bought a lot of Greek debt, okay, thinking that in the future, in fact, the rate of return may increase because they knew that Greece would have problems in the future. But right now, everything was well. So people was going, borrowing, buying bonds, and so on. Okay? And why did we have this problem? It's called the credibility paradox. I'm sorry, I'm using a lot of paradox. Credibility paradox has been developed by an economist, a Keynesian economist, who is working at the BIS, which called Claudio Borio, is one of the greatest guy. If you go on the website of the BIS, he's the chief economist of the BIS. Claudio Borio, B-O-R-E-O, developed this idea of credibility paradox. In other words, the central banks, just before the crisis, were looked as doing a very, very good job. The world economy was growing fast. There was no inflation. This was called the Great Moderation. I'm sure you heard about this expression. Everybody was confident. If they had learned Minsky, which was not the case, they would have said to themselves, "Ooh, we have to be careful. We are in a situation of the tranquility paradox because we are doing so well. There is so much confidence in our policy that the result is that banks, investors are taking risks and preparing the next crisis." This is very interesting. This is the view developed by Minsky, and one of the reasons why he thinks that the financial system is fundamentally unstable. Even if, when things are doing well, next crisis is coming. It's a cyclical effect, if you want. So the idea that we should separate monetary stability and banking and financial stability is a very bad idea. In fact, we need to think that when you have monetary stability, this may lead to financial instability. This is what Minsky taught us. And the conclusion of all of this is that central banks should deal both with monetary and financial stability, which is the case now. Due to the crisis, or thanks to the crisis, if you look at what has been done by the Fed in the US, the Bank of England, the Bank of Japan, the ECB, and so on, all central banks, the Chinese central bank also, all of them now deal with the question of financial stability. The separation principle has been abolished, okay? This was a very important thing, okay? So, there was also before the crisis, something which I'm sure you know about, is that central banks should have only one objective, inflation, and they should have what were called inflation targeting. In other words, they should say every year, at the beginning of each year, my target this year is, let's say, 2% inflation. And if they are credible, then the expectations would be such that inflation would be, in fact, 2%. This was the view of the economists and the central bankers. This has to do with what we call also rational expectations. Okay, if everything is going well, if the central bank is credible, then there is no reason why the expectation shouldn't be 2% if the central bank says it's going to be 2%. Okay, so it's a very specific view of inflation. For instance, the role of wages, the role of cost is not important. What is important is the role of the monetary institutions, because in this view, what is important for inflation is money, and this is the view of the monetary quantity view, as you know, okay? And the other factors are not important. So this view now is completely also demolished, I would say. Inflation targeting is not anymore credible framework for central banking. In fact, if you listen to what central banks are saying today, listen to the Fed, listen to the leaders of other central banks, they don't talk too much about inflation. In fact, they should talk about deflation more than inflation, but also they look at other dimensions of the system. They talk more about financial instability, markets, okay, than the question of financials, of price stability. So this is important, as this is a new change in the way central banking is being working. Okay? So there has been a lot of discussion also, maybe you read papers on that, on the major function of the central bank, which is the function of lending of last resort, lender of last resort. Okay? When banks are in trouble and they have a liquidity problem in particular, central banks can create liquidity and inject liquidity, lend liquidity to the banks so that they would avoid a collapse. This is very important. And this has been playing, this function has been very, very, very important in the recent years. Okay, the Fed, the ECB, the Bank of Japan, and so on. It took different forms. I'm sure you heard about the quantitative easing, for instance, policies, okay, which is one way to lend money to the banking system and sometimes even directly to business firms to avoid a collapse of the economy in terms of crisis, in times of crisis, okay? But there was a debate about the role of the central bank, because if they are in charge of stability, and if they are in charge of financial stability, I'm sorry, and monetary stability, then when you have two targets, you need at least two instruments, because you may have conflicts, okay? So in the previous framework, the only instruments of central banks was the interest rates. They were, you know, influencing on the markets. So the idea is to provide central banks with new instruments, prudential instruments, for instance, to give them a wider array of instruments to be used as they have more than one target to accomplish, to look at, okay? So the operational framework of central bank, what we call the operational framework, that is the targets on one side and the instruments to reach the targets on the other side, has been completely enlarged, broadened due to the crisis. So this has been a major change. Okay. So here, the specific case of the Eurozone. In the Eurozone, we had another problem, is that in top of the banking crisis, we had a sovereign debt crisis, in the sense that some countries, like, of course, Greece, Ireland, Portugal, Spain, got into trouble because their sovereign debt went very, very high, and they were under the speculative attack on the market, by the markets, and they needed to be defended. So the central bank, the question, this raised the role of the central bank, okay? So the bank had a lot of losses, okay? So the governments rescued the banks, but this led to an increase of sovereign debt. We had a vicious circle. And the increase of sovereign debt led to more speculative attack on banks and on countries which were, on banks which were holding the bonds and on countries which were issuing the bonds. So we had a huge vicious circle in Europe. And one of the major reasons why it happened in Europe and not in the US, not in the, when I say Europe, it's the Eurozone, I'm sorry. It didn't happen in, not in the UK, not in the US, is because the role of the central bank in these two groups of countries is not the same with respect to its role of landing of last resort. Let me be clear about that. In the US, in the UK, the central bank decided that it would intervene not only to rescue banks, to provide banks with liquidity, but also it would intervene on the bond market, public bond market, to help government which had a high level of debt due to the rescue of banks to cool down the situation. Because when a central bank is going on the market to buy bonds, the rate of the bonds goes down. So the price of the debt, interest payments of the debt, goes down. And this is, the Bank of England did that, the Fed did that, and this is why there was not a sovereign debt crisis in these two countries. Whereas in the Eurozone, due to the Maastricht Treaty, it is forbidden, the bank, central bank, cannot intervene on the bond market, public bond market, because it cannot provide finance directly to governments. Okay? This is seen to be very bad to finance debt government deficits. Okay? So due to this very ridiculous and very constraining role, we had a huge sovereign debt crisis in Europe, which is not over now yet. Okay? And whereas in other countries like the UK or the US, which, by the way, the US has a level of debt higher than country on the average country of the Eurozone. Okay? So we have a very difficult situation due to institutional reasons, to political reasons, and due to the role of the central bank. Am I clear? Okay, we may come back to that if you want to tell us in a moment. The fourth point is the bank failure. Maybe I'm going, not going, oh là, je vais pas arriver à tenir mon temps. Okay. Okay. Another problem is the bank failure, what we call bank resolution. In resolution in English, it's the same word in French in English. What we have seen with the crisis? We have seen that large banks are too big to fail. Why? Because if one of them goes into bankrupt, we have a systemic risk here. All the other banks may get into trouble because banks are interconnected. So if one bank goes bad, the other one are going to get into trouble. Okay? The idea also is that bailing out banks, in other words, rescuing banks by public funds, by, for instance, taxes, is supposed to have two, this is orthodox view, two negative effects. One, what we call the moral hazard effect. If too big to fail banks know that they're going to be rescued in any case, they won't manage risk, you know, in a very strict and rigorous way, because they know that they would get money from the government if they are in trouble. Okay, this is a moral hazard effect. And puis the second effect is what is a government deficit effect, which is if the government is going helping banks, then is running a higher deficit, and it creates a sovereign debt crisis problem. Okay, so this is an interesting consideration about this question of bank resolution. So it was decided to create or to implement new measures to solve, or at least to solve partly, this problem of the resolution. One is what is called, what we call the living wills. I don't know if you ever heard this expression. What is this idea? What is the idea? The supervisors are asking banks to decide in advance, before they get into trouble, what they would do if they get into trouble. In other words, what assets they are going to sell, what organization, what they would change in the organization of the bank, and so on. This is what we call the living wills. In such a way as when the bank gets into trouble, if it gets into trouble, it can react very quickly, and the authorities can impose to the bank, say, look, you said you would do this and that before, you have to do it. Because it's one thing to say, I'm going to do that when everything is going well, and when you are in trouble, you don't behave in the same way. So it's one way to push the bank to be very serious about what they would do in case they get into trouble. So this is the role of the living will. Another measure which has not been implemented is the taxation of banks. It was proposed, and the G20 asked the IMF to propose solutions for taxing banks to have a huge international fund which would raise this money from banks and be able to provide money to the banks when they are in trouble so that the taxpayers would not pay, okay, and we could rescue banks without increasing the budget deficit, the government deficit. But unfortunately, this was most countries refused that. But it was a good idea. But okay. Now, the other idea is to have a bail-in system. Is to say, look, it's not the taxpayer who should pay. It should be the shareholders. And hence, we should have very strict rules so that to see that shareholders and creditors of banks should pay. And certainly not the depositors, for instance, you and me, people who have money in the banks. It should be shareholders and large creditors, the ones who are lending large amounts to the banks. Okay? So this was decided. In most countries, more or less, it was a kind of improvement. Now, the question of separation, it is the fifth and last question. I'm sure all of you heard about the Glass-Steagall Act in the US in 1933 under the Roosevelt administration. Just after the great crash of the 30s, Roosevelt decided to separate completely the deposit banks or retail banks, if you want, from the investment banks. This was done. And a lot of work has been made by economists showing that clearly this was a factor, a major factor of stability of the banking system in the US, you know, in the 40s, in 1940s, up to the 70s. Okay? So there are strong arguments to go back, of course, to change the rules, but to go back to this idea of separation. Okay? So the problem is that in Europe, in continental Europe in particular, we have what we may call a universal banking or bank model. All banks, big banks in Europe, in particular in continental Europe, that is in Germany, France, Spain, Italy, Netherlands, and so on, are universal banks. In other words, they are banks who are on the retail business, but as well on the investment business. And these raise a lot of problems of stability. Because, in fact, first, these banks are too big because of their huge amount of different activities. Okay? And since they are extremely big and too big to fail, they are extremely powerful, and they have a lobby extremely powerful. We can put pressure on governments and authorities so that reforms won't be made. And in particular, this is why in Europe, continental Europe, but also in the UK, but also in the US, this idea of separation was not implemented. Okay? Because the lobby of these huge banks, lobbying has been so powerful, so efficient, that they prevented any serious reforms in this field. Okay? For me and for many economists today, I think we are a majority now, more economists in Europe, thinking that separation would be very useful. It's a necessary condition for bank stability in the future. But I'm very pessimistic because when I look at what has been done and decided in most countries, this was not the case. No separation, no serious separation. Okay? Now, I will go fast now, but just to show you what kind of reforms have been implemented, and I will take three examples. One is the Basel III reform. The new Basel Committee reform, just after the beginning of the crisis, 2010. In the US, you had the Dodd-Frank Act by the first Obama administration, And in Europe, you have what we may call, what we call the European Banking Union. So just to give you a fast example. Now, the Basel reform made some improvements. I won't go into the details, but some improvement with respect to procyclicity. At least they recognized this idea of procyclicity, and they reduced procyclicity by introducing what they call a countercyclical buffer within the new ratios. Okay? If you have questions, I will go back to that. I don't now go into detail. They introduce at last a new liquidity ratio to force the bank to hold enough liquidity to avoid liquidity crises, the one we saw in recent years. But again, for me, this reform raised a problem, is that it put too much emphasis on the capital ratios. So banks would be more dependent on capital market, where they raise funds, you know, to shareholders. And one thing I did not mention is that the shadow banking, for me, system, one of the reasons why it developed so quickly is due to the fact that the banks tried to avoid the costly prudential regulation by creating new forms of intermediation outside the official banking system. And for instance, the fast development of securitization of loans in the US, but also in the UK, in France, and other countries like that, can be explained by the fact that by securitizing their loans, the banks would not have to have a high level of own funds, because the risk was sold to investors, okay, through securitization. And the development of the shadow banking system through the securitization industry can be explained, for me, by the existence of this very high level of capital funds. Okay? So it seems to me that the Basel Committee went too far in using these instruments to deal with this question of banking stability. But it's a question in debate. All of my colleagues would not agree with that necessarily. Okay? So in fact, there is an internal contradiction in the Basel system. On one side, its goal is to provide bank stability, but in fact, it creates the condition for future instability by pushing banks to avoid the official banking system and create shadow banking, which is not, you know, under regulation. And for me, there is a problem here. Okay. The Dodd-Frank Act, I won't detail it because we don't have much time, but you have to know that in the US they have a very comprehensive new form of regulation. Comprehensive, but not going very, very far in terms of deepness. For instance, one of them is the Volcker Rules. I don't know if you heard about it. Paul Volcker was at the head of the Fed in the 70s. He's a very famous guy, you know, because he was the one who decided to change monetary policy, you know, suddenly, and we had a huge increase in interest rates and so on in the late 70s. He's an advisor of Obama. Okay, now, he's an advisor of Obama. And he tried to push new rules which deal with the question of proprietary trading. What is it? Banks are prohibited, should not use their own funds to make speculation. Okay? So they should not trade with their own funds trying to make money, because if they lose money, then their own funds are going down and then they are in trouble. This was presented by Volcker as the way to introduce a new form of banking separation. And I can't understand how Volcker can say that, because it's completely different, okay? So, in fact, it was a tricky measure to say, look, we have organized a form of banking separation, which is not the case, and they did not do a type of new type of the separation like the Roosevelt administration. Okay, so in the U.S. we can say that the reform has been very, very, very limited. Okay, just to give you one example. Okay, another example. Banks now have to keep 5% of the securitized loans in their balance sheets. In other words, when banks are making securitization, in the past they could make securitization of 100% of their loans. So they could get rid of all their loans by selling them on the market. Now the idea is that they should keep in the balance sheet at least 5% of this loan. Why? It's a moral hazard argument. In other words, if banks know that they won't be able to sell all their loans, then they will be very careful in managing risks with respect to the loan they are making to their customers. Okay, but for me, 5% is not enough. It should be 20% or something like that to really push banks to be very careful. So it goes in the right direction, but it's a very limited measure. Okay, now to some extent we can say that it's in Europe that the most important reform has been made. I don't mean it's very ambitious, but it was decided to make a very broad reform with respect to the banking regulation. So the European Banking Union was created 2 years ago, and here we have three pillars. One is to decide that the ECB is going to become the single supervisor of banks. So you see no more separation between banking stability and monetary stability. It's clear now. The ECB is a unique supervisor. We have a huge European common European insurance deposit system. So I don't know if you are aware what is an insurance deposit system. In all banking systems, you have this type of system. In other words, when you deposit some funds in the bank, the bank should keep a small part of it as an insurance fee, which is deposited to a fund, okay, a national fund, okay, which is used in case of banks in trouble to pay back the depositors. This is what we call the common insurance deposit system. And we have also a European-wide resolution system. Just a few words about that. The problem of Europe is that we have different regulations with respect to resolution, to bankruptcy, if you want. The bankruptcy law in Germany are quite different with the bankruptcy law in France, in Italy, in Spain, and so on. So what happens? Well, the banks and the investors are playing with that. They are going into the countries where the rules are less constraining. So one way to stop this kind of what we call regulatory arbitrage is to have a common system, and this was decided. Now, we can make many, many criticisms with respect to this banking union system. It goes in the right direction, but first, we have a problem with the geographical scope of this union, because this union is only for the Eurozone. And the UK, as you know, is not in the Eurozone. And the UK is the city. In other words, the largest financial center in Europe is outside the banking union. So it's one way for banks, French banks, German banks, to escape from regulation, is to go in the UK. Because the people in UK, the authority in UK, said, no, we don't recognize the authority of the ECB. The ECB, it is the Eurozone. We are not in the Eurozone. We don't respect the authority. We don't want to comply to the authority of the ECB. So it's a big problem. Another problem, it was not decided, finally, on the European level, to deal with this question of separation of bank. There was an interesting report, if some of you are interested by this topic. It's called the Liikanen report, which was issued 2 years ago by the previous commission, for the previous commission. And it was a very interesting report. We concluded that we should have a kind of separation in Europe, okay, in the banking system. Unfortunately, the new commission now, with Mr. Juncker as the chairman of the commission, with Mr. Hill, with a British guy from the city, They are very much more liberal. They don't want to have stronger regulation, and they decided that to abandon the idea of separation. So for us, it's a big problem, because if we have, which is very likely, a banking crisis in the coming decade, we may get in big trouble, because universal banks, if one of them is collapsing, it will have a disaster effect on the whole banking system in Europe, okay? And if we have done a clear-cut banking separation, this could be avoided, you know, to a large extent. So why is it so? It's because it's a kind of vicious circle. The universal banks are so big, so powerful, that they have not only a financial power, but a political power. And they put strong pressure on governments, European authorities, to avoid any serious reforms regarding, in particular, this question of separation. Okay? So here there is what we may call a problem of democracy. Because if we would ask the citizens in Europe, are you in favor of drastic measures against bank instability? I'm sure most people would say yes, and in particular they would agree with this idea of separation. But since the powerful banks can avoid these reforms, now we are in a system which is very dangerous. So this is why I'm kind of pessimistic with respect to the future of the banking system, because it is very likely that the next crisis could be very dangerous. And one of the reasons why we may have problem is that in the previous crisis, government went to rescue the banks because they had the money to do that. But now the government has such a high level of debt, they don't have the means to rescue the banks. So the next crisis is going to be terrible, because the taxpayers won't be able to go and rescue the banks. The banks will be in great trouble. Now, last part of my presentation. I want to see, we have tried to see with this group of people working on this research program, to make scenario, as you prefer, with respect to the future of Europe and the future in particular of regulation. Okay? So we have built, as you will see, scenarios combining the goals of financial regulation, taking into account the different actors in the financial system, okay? And we provided the following. First, who are the major actors in the system? And who are going to be the major actors in the future? Three points. Private players are going to be dominant in the future. It's very likely. When I say private players, large banks and investors. Okay, but public players will play a role also, not only the Basel Committee, not only the central banks, but also the states and some international organizations like the IMF. So we have to take into account the role of these different organizations. Also, what we may call civil society, social movement, NGOs are playing a role. Of course, they don't have much pressure power now, but in the future, one of the scenarios is that they are a growing influence and they exert growing pressure on governments to change the rules of the game. Okay? The question of now is that the future, it's already the case, but the financial system in the world is organized as a network. A network relating the different financial centers. Okay? So you have financial centers in Europe. This is London. You have New York. And you have Hong Kong. So this is called, for instance, Ni Long Kong. This is one example. Okay? But you may have also, you have financial centers now in the Middle East, countries, oil-producing countries. You have also, in Asia, China, more and more, besides Hong Kong. So, of course, you have a network of financial organizations and financial centers. The question is, which one is going to be the more important? What kind of relationship between them? Are they going to compete or are they going to cooperate? probably the two of the two, what we call co-petition, cooperation plus competition. So this is the type of thing we develop. Also, this question of financial innovation as a way to avoid regulation. There is a kind of dialectic relationship between regulation and innovation. For instance, as I said before, securitization can be seen as a financial innovation, the main goal of which is to avoid the prudential regulation system. Okay? So each time the authorities are creating new rules, banks and financial investors are so smart that they would invent new products, new process to avoid a regulation. And so we have a dialectic relationship which exists, has been existing for many, many years. And in the future, this will be still very important. Now, the idea is the following. We can say that the governments and the authorities have three major goals with respect to this question of regulation. One is to provide financial stability. But another goal, which is very important, is to provide or to keep some independence. Because most countries do not want to abandon their own sovereignty with respect to their own power of regulation. Okay? So, and third goal, which is the one which is preferred by the private actors, is financial integration. What we mean by financial integration is to have a unified financial system in the world with no frontiers, so that actors can go from one country to the other, one continent to the other, one market to the other, without any constraint. Now, we have this, I'm sure you are aware of this concept of Mundell impossible trilogy. In other words, in the way things work, you cannot have the three goals at the same time. In principle, you may have financial stability and independence, you may have financial stability and financial integration, but not the three together. So this is one way we worked on this trilogy to build our scenario. And here we have three plus one scenario, which are the following for the future. Okay, one, if we combine financial stability and independence of regulatory policy, then we have what we call a fragmentation scenario. In other words, we would go toward a world where we have a fragmented space. Each government or each region would take on its own control. So this is not a globalized world. It's a segmented world. Okay, and this would be a way to achieve stability with keeping some independence. But if you combine wine and trees, in other words, financial stability and financial integration, then this is what we call the multipolar scenario. What do we mean by that? We mean a system where all countries cooperate, China, the US, European countries, and so on, okay? And this is what we call that multipolar. And they create common international organization. For instance, a world financial organization in charge of dealing with the regulation of the world financial system. Okay? This is the most optimistic and probably the most unrealistic, for the time being at least, scenario. And then we have what we call the consolidation scenario, which is two and three. Each country keeps more or less its way of its regulation, but the goal is not stability, it is integration. So this is what the business wants, in fact. The business wants to have regulation not too high and to have a system which is very integrated. The problem of this scenario, as we will see, is the most unstable one, okay? But maybe the most likely one. And if we are very, very optimistic, and if we don't follow the Mundell rule, then we have another scenario possible, which combines the three, financial stability, independence of regulation, and financial integration, which we call regional scenario. Then the world could be divided in region. You would have Europe, Latin America, East Asia, Africa, and so on. And in each region, we would have specific regulations.
Okay. This may be the case in the future. You may have East Asian countries getting together to improve regulation. European countries is already the case, more or less. In Latin America, they're trying hard, but they don't succeed so far. But you know, you can imagine a regionalized world. This is possible. Okay? So since time is going too fast, I won't detail the scenario. I will send you my PowerPoint presentation, and I will send you also a paper which we wrote with a colleague on that. But each scenario is quite different. For instance, let's take the consolidation scenario, which may be the most probable one. Then you would have the decision makers would be large private sector players, big banks, big investors, which is already largely the case. We would have a very market-friendly supervision, okay? So very light, okay, supervision. And we would have a persistent monetary and financial instability in the world economy, okay? So this is, according to us, the most likely scenario, but the worst one, okay? And if we take the scenario, of course, the best one is this one, multipolar one. It's the best world we can imagine. All countries cooperate. We create international organizations, common rules. And this is, of course, the best scenario in terms of financial stability. But government lose sovereignty. Okay? It means that government accept to lose part of their sovereignty with respect to financial regulation. Okay? This is why we're not ready for that, seems to me, today. Now, to conclude, as you can see, we are in a world of characterized by a lot of uncertainty with respect to the future of the financial system. We don't know exactly where we go. The reforms have been very timid, and we can be not very optimistic, let's say, with respect to the future. Okay? But things can change very quickly. Suppose one scenario which is possible. In one decade from now, we have a huge financial crisis, which can start from other parts of the world. It can start in East Asia, for instance. Look what happened recently in China. And this creates a huge problem in the whole world economy, not only in China or Asia. It could be the case in the US. It could be the case in Europe. And we have a big collapse of part of the financial system. So this may create such a big problem that the governments then decide to implement radical measures. For instance, separation of banks, decision to be very more drastic on the prudential regulation, and so on. So this can be a scenario. This can be a scenario in the future. But the problem, the price to pay for that would be very high. Social price, economic price could be very high. And of course, I don't know if we should wish to have such a scenario, because it could be terrible. Okay, so that's it for today.
Okay, questions.
Alors, okay. Je vais prendre les questions. Oui. Tu les marques?
Ah
oui, tu gagnes le micro. D'accord.
Camera.
Hi, my name is Teresa. You mentioned that due to the Maastricht Agreement, the ECB is different from the US and from Bank of England because it's not allowed to buy government bonds. But I believe they kind of did like a similar process when they bought some bonds from Italy, for instance, in 2011 or something like this. And could you maybe explain the difference from this process to the US, for instance?
Okay. Should I take questions one by one or? Yeah? Okay, let's go on. So you're right. The Italy was part of the Italian public debt was bought by the ECB, but on very, very strict conditions. I don't know if you recall, Mr. Trichet wrote a letter to the Italian government saying, we lend to you, but you have to do this and this and that. Very specific reforms with respect, for instance, to the retirement schemes and so on. So in the US or in the UK, it's not the case. When the central bank is buying bonds, public bonds, it doesn't put conditions. There's no conditionality, if you want. Okay. So this is the first difference. But your question is interesting because it seems that the ECB is changing progressively its philosophy, going into the direction of being more active on the market for government bonds. Mr. Draghi is a very pragmatic guy. He realized that if the ECB does not go on the market, public bond market, this can create a very difficult situation for the whole Eurozone economy. So he not only Italian bonds, but he bought also Spanish, Portuguese public bonds. But this led to a conflict, a huge conflict between Mr. Draghi and the German authorities. Some of them resigned from the ECB board. Okay. Mrs. Merkel was very cautious. She didn't say nothing about it. In other words, she didn't want to intervene in the debate, but the German monetary authority were completely opposed to the fact that the ECB would buy public debt of any country. So it's not a settled issue yet, but still we can say that the central bank in Europe is changing a little bit its philosophy. Third point. This is a progress, but the central bank does not intervene as massively as an important way as it does still, and it will never be the case, I think, as it is the case in the UK, in the US. In other words, we have some interventions, but very limited one. Okay, and my view, is that it should do exactly what is done in the UK and the US. In other words, when there are problems with respect to public debt in one country, the central bank should be a lender of last resort, as it is the case with respect to banks. Okay, this is what it should be, the policy of the central bank. So, it was a good question. Yeah?
Hi, my name is Carsten. I have a question regarding the financial transactions tax. Because I remember that when the fiscal compact was passed, that I think there was a debate that it should be accompanied by a financial transaction tax, which was regarded as like a way to somehow also do some like private sector involvement in the whole regulation of the financial crisis. And I have to admit that I've lost track of what the current state of this debate is regarding the financial transaction tax. So I would be interested to hear your opinion on that and maybe also some information whether we can still hope that this is going to be launched or whether this is just, I don't know, a pipe dream or something.
Okay. You might recall that in one of my slides I presented taxation of banks as one of the ways to finance the resolution of banks. In other words, to give money of banks who are in trouble without having taxpayers pay for the rescue. This was a good idea. This was proposed by the French government at that time, by the way, among others, government. But it was the US government, the UK government, Canadian government, and so on, refused, so it was abandoned. So now, the financial transactions tax is still in debate, and maybe we may come with a decision in the near future. Not a very ambitious one, but we may come with a decision. First, we have a European directive put forward by the European Commission with respect to the financial transactions tax. In fact, it was very surprising to see that the Commission changed completely her mind with respect to this FTT, financial transactions tax. Before the crisis, it was completely opposed to any idea of FTT. Why? Because the argument was it was an obstacle to the free movements of capital. And one of the
major principle of the European building or European functioning is the free mobility of goods, services, capital, and people. Okay. So suddenly the Commission changed its mind due to the crisis. And we have a very interesting directive. Interactive because it has a very broad base. It would tax not only bonds, shares, but also derivatives, for instance, which is the most important part now of the markets and also speculation. Okay, so it has a broad base, and it had also some principle to avoid tax evasion. Okay, so it was very interesting. There was what we called some governments in Europe are completely opposed to any idea of taxation, like the UK. So it was decided to have what we call a reinforced cooperation, coopération renforcée. A group of, you know, according to the European rules, if a group of countries representing at least 60%, I think, of the population and a given number of countries, I think at least 10 countries or 11 countries, decide to get together, to go together ahead on a topic, like any topic. It could be security of the toys for the kids. It could be there was a coopération renforcée for the divorce, the question of divorce. Okay, and there is a coopération renforcée now for FTT, which is in discussion. Okay, according to what I know, a decision may be taken in the coming month with respect to this FTT in Europe between 11 countries. So in these 11 countries, you have France, Germany, Italy, Spain. In fact, the largest countries are there. But of course, the UK is completely opposed, but it's not in the group. And why is it so? Because at the end of this year, we have what we call the COP21. We have a summit with respect to climate summit, as you know, in Paris. And one of the ideas is to use part of the funds which would be collected by this FTT in Europe to provide fund to the Green Fund, what we call the Green Fund, which is an international fund which is supposed to finance the ecological transition in southern countries, in developing countries. Okay? So the French government, Mr. Hollande, decided, Mrs. Merkel also agree with this idea, let's have the FTT in Europe and let's use part of it to provide financing to this Green Fund at this conference, international conference. So this is one reason why it is probable, it is likely to have a decision taken, let's say, I think we have a summit, a European summit in the 16th, around the 16th of October. Maybe it would take a decision. For me, it would be going in the right direction, but inefficient, because this will be a very limited tax, in fact. Each country is trying to limit the scope of the tax. For instance, in France, our big banks like Société Générale, BNP Paribas, are very good in derivative with respect to shares. So the French government, under the pressure of the banking lobby, trying to exempt taxation of derivative on shares. In Germany, it would be something else, I don't know. So each country has been put limit on the tax, but still the principle of the tax is now accepted, and probably a decision will be taken next month. Maybe I'm wrong, we'll see. Okay?
Hello, my name is Javier. My question concerns the role of credit rating agencies.
Yes.
It's been widely accepted that they were a major contributor to the crisis. I was just wondering if there have been any efforts towards regulating these agencies, or if there is another way to reduce, you know, our reliance on how they assess creditworthiness, and or if I don't know if there are any other, because it seems like nothing has really changed with respect to how we these agencies have been are supervised, or in a sense.
Okay.
So.
So. There is a consensus that the rating agency didn't play a role during the subprime crisis, because they gave very bad, very good rates, AAA, to papers, you know, to products which were very risky products. for conflicts of interest reasons, in fact. Well, so there was a consensus among governments, among authorities, among academics also, to say that we should be a reform of the rating agencies. But if we look at the reforms which have been taken, like in the Dodd-Frank reform in the US or in the reform directive which has been decided in Europe, they don't go very far. So what was decided is that the rating agencies in the US, because the major rating agency, as you know, are American, because Standard & Poor's and Moody's, in fact. So they are under the supervision of an authority, I don't recall the name. Okay, so they are supervised. In Europe, it's the same. Authority, rating agencies which are operating in Europe should be supervised. But the problem is what rules should we respect? And from what I know, no radical decision or no radical reform have been taken with respect to this question of conflict of interest. What do I mean by that? That what you can be a rating agency of a company which pay you for your rating, for instance. This is a conflict of interest. So one proposal which has been made by different economists is to disconnect the rating from the payment of the rating. The idea is that all firms, for instance, all banks should pay a tax which could go to a fund, and this fund would pay the rating agencies if they are rating a firm, for instance. Okay, so you would cut the link between the firm which is rated and the rating agency. But such reform, which was proposed by many economists, not only radical economists, people who are very orthodox sometimes, was not taken. Because here again, the lobbying power of the rating agency is so big. In the US, I don't have the figures, but they finance the political campaign. The Democrats and the Republicans get a lot of money from the rating agencies. So it's a big, this system is corrupted to some extent due to this, to the money. And this should be a reform also. You should forbid any connections between the politicians and these big actors. And this seems very difficult. So no, there have not been significant reforms. This would be my answer.
My name is Ioana. I have a question in regards to the tranquility paradox.
With it come to?
To the tranquility.
Tranquility paradox, yes.
You mentioned that at that time the French, German, the Spanish banks, they trusted the Greek bonds. They bought a lot of them just before the crisis.
Which is the case, yeah.
Yes. But so my question is, a lot of this trust was actually based on the books which were modified, right?
Yes.
And isn't it that the tranquility paradox worked here just not exactly for this reason? It was a coincidence that this occurred. So following this paradox in other times might be actually, might work as a adverse to the economic development, mm-hmm. you know, because mm-hmm. in other times banks can buy something they trust and this will work out and everything will be good. So being too risk averse, wouldn't it be against the economic development, and following always the tranquility paradox can work against us?
Mm-hmm. Good question.
And the second question I have is in regards to the regional scenario that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So in case this holds true, in case this scenario occurs in the future, where do you see Europe in this scenario, on which position? Thank you.
Okay, so first, yes, it is true that part of the confidence in the Greek debt just before the crisis was due to the fact that the books were falsified. And one of the banks which played a major role was Goldman Sachs, as you know, in falsifying the books. It is true, but this is the first part of your question. Second part of this question you asked, it seems to me that the role of banks is to be to manage risk. And if they don't do it, then the price of not doing it is higher than the fact of being risk adverse. Because if they don't manage the risk, and if we have a big crisis then, because the risks are not managed, the cost of this crisis would be higher than the fact
that if they had been more risk adverse, they would have maybe stopped, prevented some bad operations. So I would plea, I would be in favor of a system which would put pressure on banks to be more risk adverse, you know. I think it's better. And the role of prudential regulation is to put pressure on banks to be more risk adverse, but sometimes it does not succeed. And the reason why is the psychology of banks. In French, we call that l'aveuglement au désastre. You are blind with respect to disaster. In other words, when everything goes well, people, it's a collective behavior. People influence each other, say, look, it's good, I'm going to borrow, I'm going to make a lot of money, and it creates a collective psychology, you know, which is very which can be very dangerous. And this is why Keynes and Minsky are right. Say, you have to watch what's going on the market. At some time, you have a very very dangerous type of collective behavior. So what they call the herd effect. So, okay. So this is what we have to be very careful. So your second question was on the
regional scenario.
Yes. So regional scenario. Let me go back to this regional scenario. Here we are. So the question was what would be Europe in that? Well, we make the assumption that the Europe, in particular the euro area, would not have exploded, would be one of the major area, and you would have a Mercosur, ASEAN area, Mercosur, Arab League area, and so on. The idea is that, and I think it's an interesting idea, one way for globalization to change, to evolve, is that you would have still globalization, maybe to some extent, but also region which would develop, would create common currencies, common regulation, and so on. This can be the case in the future. Europe, even in spite of its big crisis now, is still the region of the world which is the most integrated in terms of common policies, common regulations, and so on. So the idea that Europe would still be a integrated area, but the most important hypothesis is what about Latin America? Is Mercosur going to go on? Are they going to create common regulation? What about East Asia also? So, but my feeling is that this it could be that some part of the world would be more integrated, like let's say Europe, Asia. And some other will not be very well integrated. So it depends on the local situation. One part of the world which I did not mention is Africa. Africa, for instance, West Africa and the Central Africa, they have common currencies already. They have common regulation, common central bank. So they could go on and improve their regional integration. And also, you have all this problem of Islamic finance and all this question of Islamic State, Islamic all you want. I don't know how it would evolve, but that could be also another region.
My name is Katerina. I will go back to the title of the presentation, what we learned from the crisis.
What did we learn?
Yeah, and I don't remember who told that the only thing that we learned from the history that we don't learn from the history. It feels like, and from your presentation also, I get this
impression
that banks are so powerful and they know how to play this game so much that any type of regulation or new rules are neglected very fast and they can adjust so fast. So my question, how civil society can take over? How you also mentioned it, how it possible, in which form it can be done, that civil society will dictate their own will on this kind of on these rules in this game, to change the rules, and to continue this, is the example of this, is it The project, Austrian-based project, is called Bank for the Common Good or something like this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Okay, good question. So, when I asked the question, what did we learn about the from the crisis, is that, in fact, it seems to me, speaking of we, the authority is the one who had decided with respect to regulation reforms. It seems to me that they did not learn, or they did not want to take decisions, you know, drawn from the experience of the crisis. My explanation is that it's a political answer, is that power relationships between the government and the public authorities on one side and the private players on the other side, is the balance of power is in favor of the private players. They are so powerful that they managed to stop or to limit completely seriously all forms of reform. Contrary to what happened during the previous crisis in the 1930s, where you had very strong regulations taken not only in the US with the Glass-Steagall Act, for instance, but also in France. In France, these reforms took place in 1936, Le Front Populaire, and also after the war, the gouvernement provisoire de Gaulle, we decided to nationalize the banks, to implement new rules, to make separation, and so on and so on. So there was at that time, for different reasons, in the US and then in France, there was a strong political will. In France, it was due to the war. It's a very specific historical situation, okay? Now, today, the situation is, the political situation is quite different. It's quite different due to liberalization, to the globalization, and the power of finance is such that they make the rules, in fact. They impose the rules, and they don't want to have constraining regulations. Okay, now, what should we do, or what could be done? In some countries, like Italy or Spain, for instance, you already have a lot, it's a minority. But you have banks, what they call ethical banks, cooperative banks, who play an interesting role. And they show that there are different ways of doing banking operations. Unfortunately, in a country like France, we have such situations, such banks, but they are very tiny. One of them is La Nef, Nouvelle Économie Fraternelle. It's a tiny institution, it's not even a bank, because the big banks in France put pressure on the authority so that they don't give them, the authority will not give them, the agreement to become a bank. You see how it works. So we are in a very, very difficult situation to have in France, to have ethical banks. Whereas, again, in Italy, in Spain, they are doing much better. Okay, so it seems to me that for the new generation like yours now, you have the responsibility not only of studying and understanding that new banks, ethical banks can exist, but also to become the customers of such banks. Really, if at the beginning of your professional life, you always ask yourself the question, which bank should I have? Today, people sometimes have two banks. It's very often the case, even for among young people. You should have at least one ethical bank among your two banks. You should know, really. This is very important. If it's not the case, then these banks will not become important, they would not develop, and the traditional banking will go on, and it's a very perverse type of banking. These banks are extremely dangerous by the way they behave. They are a real threat for democracy, a real threat for stability. Yes? Oui?
Hi, please. My name is Davide. I would like to ask you what is your point of view about the securitization in southern European countries, if played a major role or not? Because for what I do remember, played a major role in the US and the UK, but in countries like Portugal, Italy, Greece and Spain, did not play such a major role, and maybe was mainly a public debt crisis.
Okay. Yeah, I would agree with your view that securitization is the importance and the share of securitization is not the same in countries like UK, US, that's for sure, or northern countries. like the Netherlands. In France, we are in an intermediate situation where securitization has been developing a lot, but it's not as important as it is in the US, and it's taking different forms. So, yes, you're right to say that the major problems in southern countries in Europe is not only public debt, it's also private loans by households. In Spain, for instance, is the share of the burden of the debt is very high for private households. And yeah, I agree. The financial crisis does not take exactly the same form in the different countries. I would agree with that. But it is likely that securitization is going to develop in countries like Portugal and Spain in the future. Because the ECB, for instance, and the European Commission are very much in favor of securitization. So they would provide new rules and new incentives to develop securitization, even in southern countries of Europe.
Hi, I'm Niall. At the start of the presentation, you suggested there had developed quite a strong consensus within various establishment institutions on the need for macroprudential regulation.
Yes.
But then your analysis of the various reforms that have happened so far suggests that really there isn't been any serious measures put in place to deal with systemic risk. So I was wondering what actually is the nature of this emerging awareness around macroprudential measures, and whether or not, I mean, you suggested, of course, that there's been a lot of political influence on behalf of the banks to prevent there being any serious measures that might have controlled their interests in some way. But at some stage, there would also presumably be some sort of pushback from political elites who are fearing a next crisis. And so has this kind of changed analytical perspective, some awareness around the potential for systemic risk, is there a chance that is going to allow political elites to put measures in place before the next crisis actually emerges? Or is this kind of macroprudential consensus actually very thin and not going to make much of a difference?
That's a good question. In this respect of macroprudential regulation, I would be fairly optimistic in the sense that maybe I was not clear in my presentation, but in Europe and in the US, in both regions, they decided to create what they call a Council for Systemic Risk, which is more or less linked to the central bank. In the ECB, for instance, is in charge of a European Council for Systemic Risk, where you have all the major regulators of banks, bond market, security market, and also insurance companies. So, in fact, there have been steps taken in the right direction. My question is, is this enough to create new institutions, new groups of committees and so on? The next crisis will tell, I don't know. So I think there have been people are conscious that there is a need for macroprudential regulation. Second, institution has been created for that. We'll see. So far, it's difficult to determine if it's enough. I'm afraid it's not, but we'll see. Because it's very difficult. Macroprudential regulation has to do with systemic risk. And systemic risk can take so many different forms. It can start from the real estate market. It can start from the bond market. It can start from, specific insurance companies which are in trouble. So it's very difficult to manage that. But at least this time there is the decision has been taken to take this seriously. We'll see in the future. I don't know if this answers your question, but what is interesting is that in the US and in Europe we have these two new institutions called the Council for Systemic Risk. Yes?
Hi, my name is Esra. You were mentioning that there are some limits in the US on the amount of the securitized loans that should be shown in the balance sheet of
yes,
the banks.
Yes.
And I was wondering if there are any limits on the type of the loans in terms of the riskiness of the loans or the type, such as mortgage loans, that can be securitized or not. Because I think if we can put some limits based on the riskiness of these loans, maybe a crisis which might come from the securitized loans can be reduced, or a possible future mortgage crisis.
Yes.
Can be.
So far, the only way the things have been approached is a question of putting a limit on terms of percentage, 5%, maybe 10% in the future, I don't know. It would be, according to me, it would be difficult to classify the risk, the loans according to the degree of riskiness, because the riskiness of the loans change very much in time. Okay, because at one point, a loan to business firms could be fairly good with a lower level of risk, but then if the economic situation of the country, you know, worsens, if the rate of growth goes down and so on, then a risk which was good a few months ago can become very bad now, you know. So I think it would be tricky to have a classification of the loans, you know, a very precise one according to the level of risk. You can make category risk number one for instance, poor household, what is called subprime, you know, with low level of income. Okay, for small size business or for business in new technologies which are supposed to be more risky and so on. But it would be very difficult, according to me, to classify the loans according to the level of risk. I don't know if I answer your question. For me, there is a debate now. Should we forbid completely securitization? This would be the radical measure. Most people, economists, of course, bankers and so on, say no. We should maintain securitization. Now the question is, how should we regulate securitization? The European Commission came with the word of good securitization, which is a very vague expression. And what they call good securitization is securitization where you have transparency, you know exactly what are the assets which are securitized, and you have also a supervision which is made regularly on the assets which are supervised. And this relates to the question with the rating agencies, because one of the problems of the subprime crisis is that the rating agencies have been using risky loans, and they mix them with non-risky loans to make new assets, you know, CDOs, which were sold on the market. This is terrible, because it's impossible to evaluate the risk of a synthetic or complex product like that. So maybe we should forbid not security by securitization by itself, but the creation of this very complex, difficult to evaluate product. But the problem is that the actors of finance, in other words, investors, banks, rating agencies, are against the idea of implementing strong regulation in this field. Since they have a lot of power, again, we come back again to this question of lobbying, power, and so on, they are completely opposed to any form of strong regulation in the field of securitization. Now, there was a question of, your question about ethical bank was also on civil society. Myself, I am an activist in civil society, so I know very well, I believe that it is important, but I can tell you that in Europe, at least, we have no power at all. We try to be heard, you know, we go to Brussels to talk to the people, we meet the elected MPs, we even meet the French Ministry of Finance. I've met Mr. Sapin a couple of times about the FTT. But he listens to us, but he doesn't And sometimes when he's very frank, he says, look, you're right, but yesterday I have the bankers in my office, and they put pressure on me to change the rules or to abandon any form of reform. So the balance of power is so different between the lobby on one side and the civil society on the other side that it is very difficult. But this may change. This may change if the consumer organizations get together with the labor unions, get together with the other parts of the civil society. Maybe things will improve in the future. But so far, it's very difficult. Yeah. Oui?
My name is Mahar. My question is about the consolidation scenario where you mentioned it's better to have universal regulations implemented in a monetary union, for example, such as the EU. Mm-hmm. But in the case of Greece, we talked about it in the first seminar, I guess, that Greece did not have so much sovereignty in terms of monetary policy. So it deepened the crisis of, like, they cannot control their liquidity, they cannot print more euros. So how do we reach a compromise between the sovereignty of a country and the interest of a union?
Okay, but it's not only the case of Greece. All countries in the Eurozone have lost their monetary sovereignty. France, even Germany, Italy, Spain, Portugal, and so on. In other words, the monetary policy is decided in Frankfurt at the ECB. Of course, you have each country is represented there, but it's so the monetary union implies the loss of sovereignty, monetary sovereignty. And this is why there is a debate now with respect to the Greek crisis, but also the situation in other countries. Say, look, we should go back to the previous situation. We should regain our monetary sovereignty because we cannot manage a crisis without having any monetary sovereignty. But this would mean that Greece goes out, exits the Eurozone to gain again its monetary sovereignty.
My question was how to compromise.
Alors, to compromise, Mr. Varoufakis, the former Minister of Finance, has a plan B plan. And he said one way to compromise is, for instance, to have a parallel currency. Okay? And also to have a nationalization of banks. In other words, to gain control on the banking system. Okay? So these two measures, according to him, among others, would bring back some kind of monetary sovereignty to Greece. Okay? So these are the proposals. I agree with these ideas. I think it's are good ideas. But my feeling is that if Greece nationalizes its banks, decide to create its own parallel currency, then it would be forced very quickly to exit the Eurozone. It seems to me that it would not be a stable situation. In other words, other countries like Germany, but also France, unfortunately, or the Netherlands, Austria, would say to Greece, okay, you don't want to play the rules of the game, you don't want to have a liberalized banking system, you want to have your own parallel currency, okay, then get out. So this is why Mr. Varoufakis, I think, is not very realistic in that sense. Unfortunately, because I think his plan is very interesting. But maybe it's a good idea for Greece to get out of the Eurozone, by the way. Are you Greek?
No. Yes. Hi, Jay Christopher. So a handful of us spent the last year in Kingston with Steve Keen, and he talks quite a bit about debt and its role in financial crises. And so I was wondering, your presentation talked mostly about institutional factors and sort of the more specifics of the banking sector and how do we prevent some of the things that happened last time from happening again. And not to put words in Steve Keen's mouth, but it seems like his argument would generally be that's less important than the overall idea that there's a large amount of debt, that the debt level is so high and the leverage levels are so high that even if we have really good institutional policy, the system will find a way to crash itself. So I was wondering how you responded to that argument and just more generally about the role of debt in crises like this.
Okay, that's a very good question. I belong to a network which is called the Appalled Economists Network. I don't know if you heard of it. It's Economistes Atterrés in France. And we wrote a couple of books on the situation of Europe. And we wrote one book 3 years ago. And I wrote a chapter on this question of debt. And what I said in this chapter is that we need to have an international conference, a European, pan-European conference on debt, to have a restructuration, a collective restructuration of debt, you know, not only take the case of Greece or Spain or Portugal, all countries, we should have collective decisions and to decide to cancel part of the debt, okay, and to decide in the future to have a mutual form of debt, what we call sometimes euro bonds or stuff like that, okay, new forms of debt, which is collective debt. So I do think, indeed, that the question of debt is today the major problem in the European crisis. I did not deal about it because it was not exactly my topic, but I do think that question of debt is absolutely central, essential. And I think the first step would be to have this collective decision in Europe with respect to the restructuration of debt, which means cancellation of part of the debt, lengthening the, you know, to pay in later on, and to reduce the interest rates. And there have been many, many proposals in this direction which can be taken, you know, but the problem is that there is no political will to do so. In particular, Germany is completely opposed to any idea of debt restructuration, whereas institutions like the IMF are in favor of that. The IMF is saying now, I don't want to participate to any rescue because the major problem is debt and we have to solve first the problem of debt before we go on. So, and as you know, the IMF is not a very heterodox institution. So, but Steve is quite right to insist on the role of debt. That's for sure. This is why I mentioned the fact in my presentation, maybe too quickly, that the major problem of the European crisis not is a sovereign debt crisis. Okay. Clearly, if we don't solve this problem, we are going to be in a permanent state of crisis, in a situation of crisis.
It's about my question is about the Basel reforms.
Yes.
You said it was like just working because, not because of law, but because anyone who would disobey the Basel agreement,
yeah,
would be like punished by the market, if I
exactly
understand well.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it seems symptomatic of the fact that we cannot impose something which would not be accepted by the banks anyway.
Yes.
But does that mean that in case of, I don't know, like new bubble or crazy like growth of the if it was doing better,
yeah,
the banks could, like a few actors could decide to get out of the Basel agreement and like have enough weight to say, okay, it was just a crisis ruling and we don't want it anymore and we can bypass it anyway, in mm-hmm kind of way.
No, I don't think so. I think the Basel agreement, the Basel rules as part of the system now, really the big system, the big financial system. And not, I don't see any bank getting out, decided to get out. But they are smarter than that. They are trying to influence the decision of the Basel committee. For instance, for the Basel III rules, they made a lot of lobbying to watch, you know, the reforms and to decide, to put pressure for the authority to take the right rules, the right decision with respect to the interest of banks. So this is the way they behave. They won't say we get out of Basel, but they will put pressure to have the Basel rules being very soft, very friendly to the banks, okay. And they are very good in terms of communication, you know. For instance, what they would say, they say, look, if the rules are too heavy, too strong, then we won't lend money anymore to the business sector. This is what they say. So, and they say that in the public opinion, you know, people listen to that. And they say, if we don't lend, then rate of unemployment is going to rise, you know. The economy is going to slow down. And this is what they say, and it works very well. You know, a lot of people are convinced that too many rules are very bad for the economy. So, in terms of communication, but they have so much money. They control so well the media that it's very difficult for us, economists or sometimes activists, to have a counter speech to say, no, this is wrong. So there is an organization, by the way. You should go on its website in Brussels, which is called Finance Watch. I don't know if you heard of it. Finance Watch is an NGO created at the start. It was created by the European Commission, by the way. Get some money, not created by, but got some money. It was some MPs, left-wing MPs of the European Parliament decided to create this to do some counter-lobbying. So this is his name of Finance Watch is to watch the lobbying in Brussels and to try to see what they do and to try to say, look, this lobbying is putting pressure, is trying to corrupt the people in the Commission and so on. And they're doing a very, very good job. And if you are looking for good papers, very pedagogical papers, even videos or even PowerPoints, go on the website of Finance Watch and you will find very interesting things. So this is part, and myself, I work very much with them. They are very interesting people. The head of Finance Watch now is someone who was at the head of a bank previously. So he changed completely his mind, if I may say so, and now, but he's very good on banking. So when he deals with the banks cannot tell him bad story, you know, wrong stories, because he knows exactly how it goes. So this is how we try to do, to organize. Yeah.
Okay, I'm Soman, and I have this question which might be a little irrelevant, but...
Please go ahead.
Because recently there has been this big movement with Bitcoins, which is a kind of new currency on internet.
Yeah,
and Bitcoin, yeah. So do you think that such movements, or can they change the way we look at financial markets, or can they become a global force? And if they can, will they be transparent, or will it be possible to even regulate them? Because they are completely...
Okay, so indeed the Bitcoin has been a very important question in the last years. As you know, Bitcoin is a virtual currency, which is the goal of which is to avoid intermediaries, no banks, to avoid authorities, no bank, central banks, no supervision. Okay, and it's only among private actors, okay, which exchange this currency using electronic device, okay? So the Bitcoin has been used for transactions. You can use, if you go in some shops in France, but more in the US also, you can buy stuff if you go in a sport magazine or if you go in some specific shops, you can use a Bitcoin. But most of the time, the Bitcoin is being used as a speculative device. In other words, people use it to make money by the increase in the value of the Bitcoin. Okay, and since it's been very speculative, it's been very unstable. Okay, and since it's not regulated and it's not transparent at all, because we don't know, if you use the Bitcoin, you don't know how it works or who is ruling it and so on. It's very difficult to have a confidence in this Bitcoin all the time. Sometimes you say, oh, it's good, this value is increasing, so I'm happy, but then it goes down suddenly and you don't know why, you don't understand why. So far, for me, the Bitcoin is not a true currency, because it's my view of money. For me, money is a social institution. In other words, an institution
which need to be managed by a collective, a group of people, in a very transparent way, according to rules which are clear, and with a minimum of regulation, in other words, a group of people or an authority to regulate the system. So since the people there do not want to have any regulation, any authority, any intermediaries, I don't think it can play the role of money very in a very satisfactory way. It does not mean that in the future we will not have other experience of money, virtual money, maybe working differently in a more satisfactory way. That's possible. So, but still, so far this money did not exist yet. Okay. Microsoft, for instance, tried to create its own money using its own networks, its own organization, but so far it didn't work very well. So let's see for the future, but so far we cannot say it's very successful. But you have people who do not think like me, who think it's great, this is the future, banks are corrupted, authorities are bureaucratic, so we should avoid all this and create money without authorities, without banks, and this is the best world you can imagine. But I think these people are very dangerous. But they are what I would call libertarian people. They have a philosophy which is libertarian philosophy. In other words, they want to get rid of all forms of organization, control, all forms of organization. And for me, this is not consistent with the view I have of what is the money. Again, the money is a social institution. It should be regulated by the collectivity, by an authority, and so on. And it's not the case for the Bitcoin. So it cannot be money.
Yes. To an earlier question, you answered that one solution could be now the restructuring of debt.
Yes.
And the cancellation of
yes.
part of the debt. But don't you think this will lead back to the moral hazard that you were mentioning earlier? And I think Greece now is harshly criticized with this argument of being morally not not compliant, so to say, because countries like Portugal or Spain, they implemented a lot of austerity, and at the same time Greece is criticized for not doing that. So don't you think that canceling debt would lead to the moral hazard?
My answer would be basically no. Why no? Because if you try to understand where does the Greek debt comes from, then you would realize that it's not the fault of the Greek people. It's the fault of partly of the governments. The fact that they have some huge defense budget, the fact that they have a lot of corruption with the Olympic Games, for instance. So on. But I don't think the question of moral hazard is so important in the case of Greek debt. By the way, in Greece, there has been an audit of the Greek debt. I don't know, you can get it very easily. A book has been published in French, but if you go on the Greek, on the website of the Greek parliament, so you have to find it, but I can give you the name of the guy who is in charge of this report. It's called Eric Toussaint. Maybe you will invite him. He will make a presentation, maybe. Okay, this guy is the head of an NGO, which is called CADTM, Comité pour l'annulation, Committee for the cancellation of the debt of developing countries, of the third world. Okay, and he was appointed by the chairman of the Greek parliament to make an audit of the Greek debt. And they came with, they make a lot of computations, with data and so on. And they came with this result that a large part of the Greek debt is what they call illegitimate. In other words, is not legitimate, so it should not be paid back by the Greek people. Okay? It's due to corruption, it's due to the expenditures, defense expenditures, it's due to the fact that interest in the past paid by Greece was too high, and so on. You may not agree with this. All these conclusions, but at least
it raised the question that when a country has such a high level of debt, and when the policies which has been imposed on this country has the effect of rising the level of debt, because at the beginning of the crisis, the level of debt was 120% of the GDP in Greece, now it's 185%. So you come to the point where this debt is not sustainable. And everyone says that. You would ask most economists, most politicians, people at the IMF, all say that the Greek debt is not sustainable. So why is it that European countries, France, Germany, still put pressure on Greece to pay back its debt, which is not sustainable? I have an answer. It's one way, it's a way to control the Greek economy and the Greek people to have a debt, a high level of debt on them. France did the same thing with its African countries, for instance, which has a lot of debt with respect to France for many years. It's a good way to put pressure on a country, to control a country, to have to be its créancier, how do you say it? So we have a very difficult, in fact, the solution of the debt is a political matter, it's not an economic matter anymore. And so far, the political leaders in Europe didn't have the courage to decide that it was a political matter and it should be cancelled. You know that in 1953, 60% of the German debt was cancelled. And it was an extremely good decision, because the cause maybe of the Second World War was the debt of Germany, you know, the Treaty de Versailles. So
part of it was cancelled by Greece as well at that time?
Yes, Greece was part of the countries which... Exactly. So now we are in a situation where we have not only a moral, but a political necessity of cancelling the debt. Otherwise, we are going into deep trouble in the future. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Sebastian. I'd just like to go back on the FTT question.
On the
financial tax transaction question.
Financial consolidation?
Tax transaction.
Oh. Yes.
And I know that 2 years ago I was on internship on a council in France, Conseil d'analyse économique, and I worked on some European Commission works about the fact that we could also implement what they called FAT, financial activity transaction.
Yes.
And I know at this time it was a real debate, and European Commission and French government didn't know if we should take one or the other.
Yeah.
Because the FAT is somehow different from FTT, because it's maybe more equal, because it's, it reduces the sector problem, because I think in the financial sector there was no value-added taxes.
Exactly, yes.
And so I wonder why is this debate now? Is it still a debate going on? And what do you think about that kind of taxes? Is it applicable, and is it something we could watch in the future?
Well, yeah, you can imagine that we may have a financial activity tax. In fact, it's what's called a FAT tax. The IMF, when recall that I mentioned that the IMF was asked to prepare proposals for the G20 about 5 years ago for taxation, international taxation, and in particular on banks. And it came with a FAT tax, in other words, financial activity tax. So it's quite possible. Your question is why it's not used. Well, myself, I'm not too much I'm in favor of such a tax, but I'm in favor of both. We're having a FAT tax and a FTT tax. FTT, why? Because the FTT, like the Tobin tax, is supposed to fight speculation. In other words, when you tax transactions on the markets, you reduce the return on transactions, and then you may reduce the transactions, speculative transactions. This is what Tobin and Keynes himself in the 30s proposed such a tax. Whereas the FAT tax, like the added value tax, is not designed to fight speculation, but it's still it could be a very good tax. So now your question. So I agree that I would be in favor of both taxes. They are not exclusive from one for the other. Now, why? By the way, the financial sector, taken as a whole, is a sector of the economy where the level of taxation is the lowest compared to any other parts of the any sector of the economy. Now, why is it so? One reason is because you have tax evasion, which can be easier, supposed to be easier in the financial sector, because due to the mobility of capital, if you have taxation in one country or one region, let's say Europe, then the capital would go elsewhere. But it can be shown, and the Commission has shown by its studies and the directive, that you can find ways to limit tax evasion. For instance, Volkswagen would initiate a share, in Germany. This share was going to be transaction would take place, let's say, in Singapore. What you have what you call the residence principle, no, the emission principle. In other words, when a share has been issued in a country or in a region like the Eurozone, the tax is paid even if it is the transaction is taken place at the other part of the world. So this is typically what the Commission proposed, is such principles like emission principle. Another principle is called the residence principle. Any financial unit, banks, investors, and so on, having a transaction in the Eurozone, for instance, and is having an office in the Eurozone, is going to be to pay the tax, even if it's a British, even if it's an American firm. As long as it has an office, a branch in the Eurozone, it has to be taxed. Okay? So what does the Commission mean by that is that you can find principles which are very strong, very efficient in limiting tax evasion. So this is the first reason, tax evasion. And the second reason, I'm sorry, you will find that I'm repeating myself, why don't we have financial transactions taxes or activity taxes, financial activity taxes, is because of the lobbying. The banking system is so powerful that each time there is such a project of having a taxation, they fight very efficiently to kill the reform, to kill the measure. So that's the way it is. Yes.
Hi, I'm Helen. My question would be, because your topic was financial regulation initially.
The topic on, louder please.
The topic was financial regulation.
Yes,
initially.
Yes.
So when the banks and hedge funds and whatever started lobbying in Brussels, that was maybe in the 1980s.
Yeah.
So Finance Watch was only created in 2010.
Yes.
After you said it's an initiative of the European Commission.
Yes.
So if I'm supposed to trust a civic society, that's like not very convincing. And if I look at the situation at the moment, what would be like, what would any sober mind actually really think that we can change something? Because it's not only David against Goliath. Isn't this like far bigger? If
yeah.
Like Brussels is full of all these like
I know.
Very experienced lobbyists, and on the other hand, you've got like
sure.
a five-year-old lobbyist.
To give you figures, you have only in the financial sector, you have 1,200 lobbyists in Brussels, only in the financial sector. Financial Watch people, which is the only counter lobby, there are about 50 people. Okay? So, when you see that, you can see. But you know the story of David and Goliath? Okay? David was a little guy, and Goliath was a huge guy. And in the story, David won the fight because he was smarter. Okay? So, it doesn't mean. It's not because you're big that you're going to win all the battles. So my conviction is that we may lose some fights, but we may win the battle in the end, because, as I said before, if we don't change the rules and if we don't improve regulations, we are sure to have huge and important financial crisis in the future. And maybe the next one will change the mind of the people, civil society, electors, and maybe politicians. So,
hi, I'm Floriana. I know this is quite a broad question, but I wanted to wonder if you could talk a little bit about how the role that the German banks and also French, I guess, played in the Greece crisis.
Yes.
And your opinion on the matter, on the subject.
Okay, very good question. In 2009, when we had the first stage of the Greek crisis, the Greek sovereign debt crisis, the majority of the Greek debt, of Greek public bonds, were held by European banks, some Asian banks, also some US banks, but most were European banks. And among European banks, two countries, Germany and France. Okay. The rescue plan in 2009 for Greece, I think they received about 200 something more than 250 billions of euros. If you look at the way this money has been used, you can see that 70% of this money went back to pay the creditors. In other words, the bank, this money was used to pay, to borrow, to buy the debt that the bank want, the French and the German bank want to get rid of. Okay? So the conclusion that we made, that economists made at that time, is that most of the money that was given to Greece, but it was the case also for Ireland or for Portugal to some extent. It was the same scenario. But for Greece, at least, it was clear that it was the French and the German banks who took advantage of this money. In other words, they got back the money due to this plan. Okay? So, there is a huge responsibility of the banks, but also of the French and German authorities. In other words, they were defending their own banks before trying to solve the debt crisis, you know, of Greece. And this was very well explained in many, many media. Media from all sides. For instance, if you read The Economist, or if you read the papers on left papers, left side paper, left wing papers, both of them said that. Okay, so in other words, the banks were so powerful and they were so much fearing to lose money with respect to the Greek debt that they were, you know, fighting very hard to get their money back, if I may say so, and to get rid of their of the Greek debt. So what happened then to the Greek debt the following years? All banks, all private banks, got rid of the Greek debt. Who got, what organization or what institution got the Greek debt? The ECB, we mentioned Italy, but also the ECB bought some Greek debt. The French public institutions, okay? The German public institution, okay? And the IMF, I think. I'm not sure for the IMF. But now, the European Mechanism of Stability, which is a European fund which been created after the crisis. So what I want to say is that all private actors got rid of the Greek debt, and the Greek debt now is held massively by public institutions, official institutions. Okay. So what conclusion can we draw from that? We can draw the conclusion that if, since it is held, the debt is held by public institutions, it's our government, in fact, to decide. And they could very well decide to cancel part of the debt. Okay? Because, in fact, it's, It's our money, in fact. It's the money of the taxpayers. The problem is that I'm not sure that if you make us ask people, are you ready to pay for the Greek people? In Germany, people would say no, certainly, because the propaganda has been so high. You know, people in Germany are so much against the Greek government, the Greek way the Greek system has been working. But in France, I'm not sure it would be as much like that. In other words, if our government had the guts to explain to the public opinion that there is a need of solidarity to cancel part of the debt of the Greek people, and then to some extent to solve the future of Europe, then that would be much more interesting than what was done. Because now we are in a situation when the Greek crisis is going to go on, since the level of Greece, of debt in Greece, is still extremely high. Okay, and why is it that the IMF is saying that it does not want to be part of the negotiations anymore? Because in the status of the IMF, it has the obligation to lend to countries which are only, comme on dit, solvable, supposed to be able to pay back. And the IMF knows very well that when a country has 185% of its GDP for the debt, it will never pay back. So Mrs. Lagarde, at the head of the IMF, said, no more. Okay, not only because she's a very liberal, orthodox person, but in fact, she is constrained by the rules of the IMF. And it is very surprising to see that in Europe, in the Eurozone, countries like Germany, France, and so on, Italy, do not realize that this country and other countries, maybe other countries like Portugal or even Italy, I'm not sure that the debt of Italy is sustainable in the long run. So it's very strange to see that there is no move to decide to solve the problem of debt, and this is why the question of debt is extremely important.
Okay, there are a few last questions, so we will group all the last questions, okay. So we will give a collective answer. So where are the questions? One here. Okay, four last questions.
My name is Jia Huan, and I'm from Taiwan, and I would like to ask that in the future, is it possible that different banking sectors or maybe financial banking units or financial sectors that will apply different financial regulation standard. For example, like investment banking, we will apply more strict regulation. And for other banking units, like commercial banking, we will have a more loose regulation. And the other question is like, I would like to take China as an example. Because we know Chinese government is a very highly regulated government, and it control renminbi inflow, outflow, and even onshore renminbi or offshore renminbi. It's all very like highly controlled. However, in the like their money transaction, like retail level, to the every Chinese people, or especially in Shanghai or Beijing, they are like they don't need to take out the money, and they just need a mobile phone and they can do transaction. Like if the parents, they want to give the allowance to the children, they don't need to even like give them the physical money. They just need the mobile, and then they can transfer money. However, this company, they are not even a bank or a financial sector. And is it gonna be a major problem in the future that this kind of company will do something harmful to our financial instability?
Okay.
Second one.
Hi, my name is Anna, and I would like to ask a question. I don't know if I'm right, but it seems that regulation at a supranational level is the most fundamental process now to prevent the worsening of financial stability, and we know this is highly linked to problems in our real economy, like increasing of poverty, inequality, unemployment, etc. And yet, when you build these scenarios, these look like the most faraway scenario. So, and especially because you answered the question of my colleague, and it seemed like civil society is still a little bit a dissipated force, a not sufficiently organized force to lead to a supranational institutions and supranational decisions. So I would like to know, what, in your opinion, are the main forces or the main actors you identify as being capable of leading to an effectively supranational regulation?
Hi, I'm Erika, and I would like to ask you just two clarifications on the part of your presentation concerning what reforms have been implemented, specifically on the European Banking Union. I just didn't understand whether the European-wide common insurance deposit system and the European-wide unique bank regulation systems are going to be implemented for major banks, national banks, or generally in the broad, wide banks, national banking system of the EU member, of the European currency member states. And the second question is, if these two systems are going to become mandatory requirement for future countries who want to join the Eurozone, as well as the other Maastricht criteria, for instance. Just this.
Hi, my name is Alessandra. Maybe my question will sound a bit naive compared to the other questions, but just because I guess when we were talking about the scenarios and the likeliness that we will move into a scenario of more instability, and do you actually see us moving, maybe not now, but if we do move into a scenario of more instability, actually moving away from finance-led capitalism at some point, if we do reach a level of instability? And I'm not talking maybe about financial regulation, but the size of the financial sector compared to the real economy.
Well, thank you for these questions. So there was a question on China. I'm not a specialist of China. But from what I see, the Chinese system is a very paradoxical system, because on one side, you have a very strong state, very strong regulation. But as you mentioned, on the other side, there is a lot of freedom left to the people to make transactions, to use their mobile phone, for instance, and no strict regulations on the transactions. I would even say that I understand that the government, the Chinese government, pushed the people to go on the market to make money. You know, there was a kind of pressure, but not pressure, but the governments did not restrict people from going and speculate, in fact, on the financial markets. And this is very strange to me, because it's true, when you have a bubble, all bubbles blow. So it was strange to see that the government did not say, look, be careful, the bubble is going to blow one day. This is why there is something I do not understand very, 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 very well. But what is interesting in what happened about 2 weeks ago is that for the first time we had a kind of the beginning of a financial turmoil at the world level, which started in a big emerging country, China. Okay, it started in China, and then it went to the US, to Europe, and so on. So it shows two things. It shows first that now emerging countries are part of the world financial system and play a major role now. Like, of course, China is a huge country, but it could be the case with tomorrow with Brazil or Argentina and so on. And second, it shows that now we have a huge communication between the countries. In other words, the propagation of shocks, of crisis from one part of the world now to the other part of the world is immediate, it's very quick, very fast. So we are in a very, very dangerous world in this respect. This is why myself, I am in favor of what I would call financial protectionism. In other words, we need to have some kind of protections. Countries or regions should put protections to limit the free mobility of capital, because it's becoming very dangerous. Okay. So I'm not sure I understood. I answered all your questions, but now, the supranational financial regulation. So yes, I do think it's extremely important, and that since we have a globalized world, a globalized financial system, we need to have a supranational financial regulation. We can see that civil society so far is there, its role increased a little bit, but it's not playing a major role. So your question was what should be done, who should play a major role? I think it's the government to play that role. I don't see other solution. And government, under the pressure of the electors, you know, and also civil society, should take steps toward more regulation. So far, the government didn't go very far, as we have seen in the US, in Europe, and so on. But again, in the next crisis, that might be different, because the next crisis may be even stronger and more difficult to tackle than the previous one. So maybe things will change. People are going to get upset. You will see bank runs, people getting out of the bank because they'd be afraid to lose their money and so on. This will create some psychology in favor of change, in favor of more reforms. So that might be the scenario. I'm not sure of that, but at least I must say that the public authorities have a major role to play, and they did not play correctly their role in the past period. The French government, for instance, is very criticized now in the public opinion because he didn't push important reforms. So in the public opinion, people are aware of that. So in the future, maybe it would be difficult for next government to not to make reforms. But maybe I'm wrong. Eh? Now, the banking union, you're right to raise the question. You have three pillars. The first pillar is a central bank as a unique supervisor. In fact, it's a unique supervisor only of the biggest banks, about 120 banks, something like that. Because we have, in Europe, we have 6,000 banks, I think. So the idea is to have the central bank look and supervise the largest banks. Okay. Now, with respect to the other pillars, it's not clear for me, but it's not clear for me also, I think, because the reform is under discussion, under negotiation, because the countries do not agree. Some countries would like to have all the banks, France would like all the banks to have the European insurance system, whereas Germany do not want. Why? The explanation is simple. In France, we have only the five major banks make 80% of the business. In Germany, you have only one bank, large bank, the Deutsche Bank. You have hundreds of small banks. So the German authorities do not want to have a European system to control or to supervise through the insurance system the German bank, because they think they would lose some of their supervisory power, some of their sovereignty, in terms of controlling their own banks. So the French and the German do not agree, because the banking system are quite different. So it will take a long time, and some people say that the next European banking crisis will probably take place before the three pillars of the banking union are ready to work. So now, are we going to move away from finance-led capitalism? So far, if I look at for the coming year, the coming decade, no. We could have thought that with the financial crisis, we would go to a new capitalism, like we did from the Fordist capitalism. I don't know if Robert Boyer mentioned that when he came. We had different historical stage in capitalism. Fordist capitalism in the after-war period, and then finance-led capitalism. What is going to be the next one? Maybe knowledge-led capitalism for some economist or some other. No, my feeling, my analysis is that finance-led capitalism is going to change, but not necessarily in the good direction. It's going to be more concentration, more instability, we are still bound to live in this system for a while, I'm afraid. So.
I'm sorry if I'm not very optimistic.
Thank you very much.